Welcome to the next learning unit in the chapter on solar inverters. In the last unit, we learned about different ways to convert direct current into alternating current. An essential criterion for being able to compare different inverters with one another is their efficiency. Let's look at how this efficiency is defined. It is the ratio of the power at the inverter output to the power at the input. The input power here is the instantaneous theoretical MPP power of the PV generator. As we have seen, the inverter performs two main functions: finding the optimal operating point, that is the MPP tracking, and the conversion of direct current into alternating current. Both functions are each described by their own efficiency. The MPPT efficiency, that is the efficiency of the MPP tracker, which was already explained in the first learning unit of this chapter, and the conversion efficiency. The total efficiency of the inverter results from the product of the two efficiencies. In the data sheet of an inverter, you will usually find an indication of its maximum efficiency. However, this peak efficiency is only achieved with a very specific input power and voltage. The efficiency is not constant, but depends significantly on the input power and the input voltage. Let's take a closer look. Here you can see a typical diagram showing the efficiency curve of an inverter. On the y-axis, the total efficiency is plotted. On the x-axis, we see the ratio between the instantaneous output power and the AC nominal power of the inverter. Thus, at a value of 100%, the inverter delivers its maximum possible power. At 50%, it delivers only half of its rated power, and so on. It can be seen that the efficiency is very low at low power levels. This is mainly due to the self-consumption of the power electronics. As the power increases, the efficiency increases and reaches its maximum at about half the rated power. At higher input power, the efficiency drops again somewhat. This is due to the ohmic losses, which increase by exponentially, or it squared with the power. Good single-phase transformerless inverters today achieve maximum efficiencies of about 97%. For three-phase devices, the efficiency is even about 1 to 1.5% higher. However, peak efficiency is of limited use when comparing inverters. To understand this, let's look at the efficiency curve of a second inverter. The peak efficiency is the same as for the first inverter. However, the efficiency is slightly higher in the lower partial load range, but drops off more at higher powers. So, which inverter is better? To answer this question, we need a value other than the peak efficiency. After all, the instantaneous power of the inverter depends on the power that is currently being supplied by the PV generator. However, the PV power varies throughout the day and the year. So, the inverter will only operate at its peak efficiency for a small portion of the time. The vast majority of the time, it will be somewhere else on the efficiency curve. Hence, we need an indication of what efficiency can be achieved with each of the two inverters over the course of a year. But how can such an average efficiency be determined? First of all, we need to know how often the different output powers are likely to occur over the course of a year. Of course, this depends very much on the irradiation, and thus on the location of the PV system under consideration. A plant in the Sahara will operate much more frequently at its rated power or even above than a plant in Germany, for example. Let's have a look at the example of a plant in Cologne, Germany, and see which energy share of the annual yield is provided by the different output powers. Of course, there are large local differences in irradiation. We see that the inverter delivers only a fraction of the annual yield at its nominal power. Most of the time, the inverter is operated in lower partial load range. This diagram clearly shows how important a good partial load behavior of the inverter is at this location. For this reason, the European efficiency eta AU was defined, which weighs the individual partial load efficiency according to the frequency of the occurrence in Central Europe. I would like to explain this formula briefly. The value eta 5% is the efficiency which occurs at 5% nominal power of the inverter. This efficiency is now weighed with a factor 0.03, so it is assumed that the inverter works 3% of the energy with 5% of the nominal power. Exactly the same is done with the efficiencies at 10, 20, 30, 50, and 100% of the nominal power. Each of these efficiencies is weighted by a different factor. The highest weighting is given to the efficiency at half the nominal power. It is included in the calculation with a factor of 0.48. Applying this formula to the inverters shown here results in a European efficiency of 96.5 for inverter A and 96.6 for inverter B. The European efficiency is, of course, only an approximation. Central Europe covers a large area in which regionally very different irradiations are to be expected. For areas with high irradiation, there's another weighted efficiency, a so-called Californian efficiency. Shown here is the energy share of the various outputs in the annual yield for a plant in Los Angeles, which is a place where high irradiation can be expected for most of the year. Here, the efficiency in the lower partial load range plays only a subordinate role. On the other hand, higher output contributes significantly more to the annual energy yield. This is also reflected in the weighted factors of the Californian efficiency. Here, the efficiency at 75% of the nominal power receives the highest weighting. For our two inverters, the Californian efficiency values are 96.8% and 96.6%. In both cases, European and Californian efficiency, the efficiencies are close to each other. However, it can be seen that in an area with less irradiation, inverter B would rather be used, and an area with more irradiation, inverter A would be used. A weighted efficiency therefore already says much more about the kind of average annual efficiency one can expect for a certain inverter. However, it must also be taken into account that the efficiency depends not only on the input power, but also on the input voltage. The vast majority of inverters sold today are two-stage transformerless in models. In the first stage, the input voltage of the PV generator is set to a certain voltage value and then converted to AC in the second stage. Conversion losses occur in both stages. Of course, these losses also depend on the voltage. Simplified, one can say that the losses in the first stage, that is in the boost or buck converter, depend on how much the voltage has to be converted up or down. If the input voltage is optimal, the voltage does not have to be converted at all and there are hardly any losses in the first converter stage. If the input voltage is very high, for example, because more modules have been connected in series in the system, the voltage must be reduced. This results in losses in the first converter stage. The overall efficiency curve is lower. The losses are even higher in the reverse case when the voltage has to be converted up. This will mainly be the case if only a few modules are connected in series or if the system is partially shaded. Here is an example. The efficiency curves are shown which results for the maximum, minimum and optimum input voltage of a two-stage inverter. This relationship now also has a meaning for the efficiency specification on the data sheets of an inverter. When calculating the European efficiency, manufacturers are free to choose which input voltage they base it on. Of course, they choose the value at which the value becomes maximum. However, a system designer usually has little freedom here, since the input voltage depends on the number of modules connected in series. In a specific PV system, the European efficiency can therefore also be lower than the data sheet of an inverter would suggest. So far, we have focused on the range of the nominal power of an inverter when looking at the efficiency curve. But what happens if the PV module produces more power? In principle, the inverter can also be operated above its rated power. However, the components of the inverter heat up with increasing power. Even at an efficiency of 98%, 2% is still lost in form of heat. To protect vulnerable components, their temperature is continuously monitored by the inverter control system. If a certain temperature is exceeded, the inverter reduces the power by regulating the operating point of the PV modules out of the MPP. This power reduction is called derating. In extreme cases, the inverter shuts down completely. Reliable housing cooling and a mounting location that is as evenly cool as possible are therefore important for the operating of an inverter. The inverter's derating is based on the temperature of the components. However, it can also be observed in the efficiency curve, provided that the higher power is applied long enough to cause critical heating. Let's summarize this teaching unit. We have seen that the total efficiency of an inverter is the product of the MPPT efficiency and the conversion efficiency. The European and the Californian efficiencies are derived from the weighted efficiencies at different output powers with respect to the rated power. However, both the peak, the European, and the Californian efficiencies are voltage dependent. Finally, we learned that the inverter can be operated above its rated power, but then the output power is reduced. Thank you for your attention.